Hallelujah. I do want to say greetings and shalom to all of those that have joined us on the live stream, whether it is audio or visual. We greet you on this Chitve Imat, Scripture Truth, New Yorkshire's mighty name. I'm certainly glad that Yah has granted unto you the opportunity to join us here on this teaching on tonight. Ask my Zachenia Ramiah, and I want you to understand that I ask and request it of him because I do honor him, that he would grant unto me this evening to teach on this matter. I believe it's vitally important. I believe it's important unto the house of Yisrael, the Beit Yisrael. There's so many things that we are unlearned of and we are very ignorant of. We base things off one of the most powerful access we have. It's a tool, but it is to our destruction. I will explain that later. I said to one today as I received a call from Chicago, Illinois, and the person was very inquisitive. Questions, questions, questions. And so I said to the person, may I ask you a question? Because when they called, they said, may I speak with Reach David Yisrael? I said, who's calling? Tell him that the person gave their name. And may I speak with him? So I implied, go ahead. But I want to speak with him. Speak, ma'am. He's listening. And so she began to ask me questions, very inquisitive as we are. And so I said to her after this litmus test that she was literally testing me by, I said, I want to ask you a question. May I please? I say, the student says to the professor that has labored for 30, 35 years, he has a great wisdom of the knowledge of the teaching for the application that he wants to instruct the student in. He's a scholar. He has scholarship. And scholarship is simply implying that one has labored intensely and understand certain parameters and the ramifications of those parameters. And that's what I want to bring out tonight. I said, if he answered the student according to the excellence of his wisdom, his understanding of the subject, and if the student has a fifth grade mindset, will the student understand what he said? Can the student comprehend the knowledge of his mind within the context of a mind that has not matured? So would the answer be relevant to the student? Or would the student begin to disagree with the one that has mastered the wisdom of that vocation that he has chosen in life? And that's the way the nation Yisrael is. We're a generation of people with, as the old ones would say, a third grade education. And yet we think we have the knowledge of the sum of the fullness of the matter. And it's not so, Yisrael. And so I ask her, does the wisdom of Yah comes by asking questions or hearing? Do you even understand what wisdom is? I'll answer that for you, is my reply. Do we truly know Yah? Do we Yada Almighty Yahweh? through the power, the revelation, Yeshua has been revealed unto us. And we know that he is revealed because there is no darkness that can hide in our bosom, in our shirt. We don't do things that will cause a demise to our own nefesh, our own life substance. When one truly yada, when one knows Yah, when one truly has that knowledge of Yah, then the light of Yeshua, because his word represents one thing, shines forth excellently. And as I was after Shabbat, I know that there are times I say things that we don't understand, because we're not a people with a ferocious appetite for Torah. And as the old Kedoshim would say, sometimes it goes over our heads. I said to this one, if your child asks you a question, does it enhance their young lives? Does it give them wisdom as to the proper application or protocol of the question that they ask? I said, it doesn't. They receive that by the perception of their eyes, by watching you, your actions, and your reactions to matters. And we are people, our eyes upon everything, but what Yah commands us. We must set our achava on the things that are above. We must have a fervent affection. I want to teach on that tonight. Of course, we all think we have the fervency of Yah's affection. And some of the most diabolical activities in our lives corrupt us. And of course, we are a nation of people, just like Yisrael has always said, it was them. They compelled me. He did. She did. I want to teach on this tonight. That's why I wanted to get started somewhat early, because I want to bring out the elements of fervency and his affection, and show us the most detrimental attack and the things that destroy it. It is not some kind of outside insidious bacteria or force. It is all within the heart of Yisrael. We don't have what we think we have. That's why it must be a constant bathing, a washing, and the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. You don't have to buy it. It makes me no difference at all. I sell truth. You buy it, you receive life. You don't, it's to your damnation and your destruction. I want to express with great attentiveness to this one word. I want to read from the Torah. I have searched hours trying to find or identify this one word in its Hebraic, its Aramaic definitive. There's only one place that it is defined, and you can only find it one place in Torah. It's not found in the chronicles of the writing of Torah anywhere. We're going to find out if we truly have true affections, or is this most damnable, convoluted, twisted concept of associations and emotions that we believe that it is the very pulsating power of Yah's great Ahab or his Ahava. We'll find that out. I want to read. I'm going to take my time, and I'm going to teach. In the book of Devarim, this is the most classic definition and the expression of what true affection is. The book of Devarim, Deuteronomy, chapter 33. And I want to read one verse here in Devarim, chapter 33. And verse 3. I want to define the words because it is important to understand the definitive. Here in Devarim, Joel deals with his house as he gives them a true understanding of what affection truly is. It is the most demonstrative power of the wonderful excellence and the splendor of Almighty Yah. And the Torah reads accordingly here in Devarim 33, verse 3. Yah says, furthermore, to all the other instructions I've given unto you, and this is indeed out of my bosom, he says, yes, Yah. Almighty Yahweh, he loved fervently the people fervently. This is the only place in Torah you may find the word fervently, and I'm going to express the elements of fervently. This is the only place whereby this word, habab, is expressed. Yes, indeed, Yah loved Yisrael fervently with a great fervency of great ahab. I want to define that. The word habab, it is to have this great compassion of love, that it is a fervent, it burns, it ignites in the presence. When you get in the presence of Yah, does it ignites a great love for him? Do you love him? You avot when you come home to your children, when you get in their presence, does it ignites a great emotion toward your children? So Yah loved Yisrael fervently. Listen to this. It is a great love that is beyond expression, but of the splendid of Almighty Yah. It is to also this fervency, this habab, it is to hide it in one's shirt, in one's bosom. It is a treasure element that one has towards one another. It is a treasure that you hide. If it's not a treasure, you don't hide it. It is something you treasure up in your charge. You hide it here, and nothing contaminates it. It's on the external. The only thing that contaminates it is what's in you. It is hidden. It is a burning passion. You have this in your bosom for one purpose, to draw together. You draw those of the house of Yisrael. Isn't that the place that a mother put the child on her jat, on her breast? Isn't there where an avat, when he brings the son to his chest, he lays his head there to assure him, reassure him, that from his shot emanates this great burning, intense, infernal affection for him? If you don't do that, something is wrong. If an avad never placed his son's chest, his daughter's head on his chest, something is wrong. If a man never grabs his wife and places her head on his bosom, something is wrong. If a man never lays his head on his wife's bosom, something is wrong. So it is with Yisrael. I'm going to bring it home. We're not going to get by, period. Walking over, the old man said to me, Zachi Mahalia, he said, we need the preaching more than we need the singing. My reply to him is, when we get the preaching in the heart right, we can sing all day. We're going to break down this damnable, vile, insidious thing that is in you. It is something, or this great driven power of Yah, it thickens and it becomes hardened, in essence, that the resolve of that affection, there is nothing that can destroy it. And so Yah loved Yisrael, again, Devarim 33, verse 3, he says, "Of or furthermore indeed, yes, Almighty Yahweh, he loved Chabab, loved fervently the people, his Yisraelite Hirusham," and he reiterates the word fervently, fervently, with great passion. That goes beyond their hearts being hardened in their sins toward him. Who did he love? All of his Kiroshim. He says to Moshe, I trust them in your hand. I put them in your hands, Moshe. He said, and they shall sit down at your feet. Everyone shall nasa. Everyone shall receive. Not some. He said, everyone shall nasa. Bear up to receive it, Yisrael. It shall be what sustained them. It shall support them. Now, he loved them with great fervency, did he not? He loved them, Haba, with a fervent love. And he says unto Moshe, they shall sit at your feet. And not only shall they sit at the feet of Moshe, he said, everyone shall nasa. They shall bear. They shall receive. They shall endure your speech, your counsel that I've sent from above. They shall endure whose word? They shall endure the words of Almighty Yah. His Dabara, not his Daba, but Yah's Dabara. The word that is intense. The word that goes beyond in essence. The Ema says to the child, stop. If that does not bring about the resolution, when she says, I said, stop, the intensity of his Dabara that he calls to utter from the bosom of his messenger, Moshe. He said, I've loved you with a great fervency. And the only thing can express the fervency of Yah's Ahava is that the power and the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach is vivid, alive, and it burns with the fire in our shot, our bosom. Anything else is superficial. It's false. It is a damnable, twisted emotion. Has nothing to do with Yah. It will not sustain you. It will not cause you to endure when there is an embattlement with your Ohotz or your Ak, because it's not based on a damn thing. It is false. It's superficial. And that is found among the nation of Israel. It is one of the most damnable, superficial people that's twisted. And of course, they don't want to sit at the feet of Moshe and hear what the Torah of Yah says. You can pretend all you want to, but I'm telling you, there's a day of reckoning. You're going to stand. We must define all things according to Yah's expression He loved them fervently. Fervently he loved all of his Yisraelite Kiddushim. He loved them chabad, with a great passion. Are we to walk in that same kind of fervency? Should we as a nation? Does the true fervency of Yah express itself? Did he not express this unto Moshe? It is one of the most profound expressions of the light of Yahshua HaMashiach. And there are things that express the very evil and the corruption of our hearts. And light and darkness cannot dwell in the same vessel. You cannot get bitter and sweet water out of the same vessel. We can appease ourselves, or we can support our own deception, but there is a day of reckoning and answering unto Yah. And I'm going to break this down element by element. It says in the book of Ezra, in the third book of Ezra, I want to show you what hinders the great fervency of this Chabad, of this great kindness and affection. And I will go through an assortment of writings of the messengers of Yah. But this is a very explicit definitive here. It writes this beautiful writing of Ezra. He writes in 3 Ezra chapter 6 and verse 57. He says, and now, O Yahweh, he said, behold, these heathens, or the Goyim, the nations, without the knowledge of your power. Anyone without the knowledge of the truth of your, or the power of the testimony of Yahshua, is a Goyim. You're part of the nations, you heathens. You're not part of the kingdom of Yah. He says, these heathens which have ever been reputed as nothing, the value is not of great substance. They have been reputed as nothing. He said, they have begun to Baal, to lord over us and to devour us. He said, there are elements that have taken stronghold over us. What is the thing that takes the stronghold over you? What is lording in your mind? What is your Baal? What is the thing that draws your attention away from Yah? This is a stupid generation. It is almost like a wicked man standing before you trying to explain truth. It's almost like a silly woman trying to teach a bath the beauty of a woman. It is like a foolish old man trying to teach a young man the excellence of youthful strength. And you see his maturation as a silly, foolish old man. So what is lording over your mind? What is your Baal? What do you bow down to and reject Torah? Well, we get into the depths, my friend. And they have begun to devour you. It is your own lordship that is devouring you. It is your own rule of your own conscience, whereby you have despised the Torah of Yah. And you're going to gravitate to your own emotions. Emotions is one of the most damnable, corrupt things that will destroy one quicker than anything. I will proceed. He said, but we, your people, Yah, whom you have called your firstborn, your only begotten. Are we the only begotten after Yahshua HaMashiach? We are the begotten of Yah and Yahshua. Your only begotten, he says, and you fervent, your fervent love. He uses the word tomim here in the fervency of his love. It is a love that is complete. It is a love that is whole. It is a love that is fervent. It is not superficial. And so he gives us an expression of the fervency of his chabad. It is one that is for me. It is a love that stretches beyond our sins. It is a love that is perpetual. It is a love that cannot be destroyed. It is a love that is for me. It is a complete love that is continuous. Although we sin, his love is not abandoned. Yet we abandon Yisrael over the smallest, most immature infractions that we perceive. We have sinned and fallen into the depths of hell, and yet Yah says, I have tomid. My love is perpetual. It is continuous. It is complete for my nation, Yisrael. You fervent lover, and given into their hands. If the world now be made for our sake, that's why Yah made it all, for the sake of man. Do we not possess an inheritance with the world? How long shall this endure? It was great agony among Israel. They were watching the world and believing that the world was progressing and moving, and they were advancing. And so the question was asked, Yah, we know that there's a great love you have for us, Tommy. It is perpetual. It is complete. Now, why are these strangers, people that are not of the commonwealth of Israel, why are they lording over us? Our minds are controlled by everything but Torah. It's controlled by everything but Torah. We hear everything that is foolish. We get happy about everything but what Yah says. We get happy about food and acting silly, being greedy and everything. But when it comes to Yah, we don't get happy. We come before him dismal. We offer nothing unto him. We don't understand the reason why. Our faces are hardened and callous, and there is no excitement. Why? Because there is nothing there. I will show you. We're not going to get by. We come before Yah and we are one to the thin. Can I ask you a question? You think that any of you all could come or go to a job as an executive or as a manager, a secretary, sit at the desk and you're nodding and wandering out in your mind, you can't stay awake? You think that would be? But yet you come to the presence of Yah. You don't give a damn. And you don't care. And yet something that is most vile and silly, you're awakened. You don't go to Walmart or Dollar Mart and nod out. You know there's something deeply wrong in your ruach, your natural and your spiritual being. Something is wrong there. And that's the truth. Hallelujah. As we understand the very approaching of the end, as Kepha writes, unto the scattered house of Yisrael in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. He tells us that the end of all things is at hand. That's a very profound statement. When the end of all things, 1 Peter 4:7, when that is at hand, what do you look forward to? There is nothing else there. He said, I want you to know that the kids, the destruction, the ultimate end, the finished product, the end of all things is at hand. He gives us warning. He gives us instruction. First of all, we must be sober. Our minds must be clear. Our hearts must be sure. We cannot be drunken in the affairs of this world. So we must be sober and watch as we watch ourselves, as you watch you, to make sure that there is a tefillah, prayer. You make palah unto Yah, that we pray without ceasing, that we cry before our Abba. He warns us. He tells us that the end of all things, not some things, He said the end of all things is at hand. Knowing that and understanding that, he tells us to be conscientious of Torah. Have our minds refreshed and recharged daily in Torah. That we meditate upon it. My issue asked me a question today. Statements, although I answered. Because I said to her, I said, Isha, when I am out working, I don't do much talking. I work. Because when we tend to talk, then frivolity and folly began to display. And you don't get things done. I will say to the Akno talk. I say the only time I talk is when I'm instructing. Did you say right? Or I may sing unto Yah. My mind is meditating on the word. But I don't have time for the folly and the frivolity and the laughter, the sporting. I want to get the job done because I have a job that I'm doing for Yah. In everything I do it as unto Him. I want His pleasure, that His love will be excited about the energy and the forthrightness I put into the effort of that. I will not slack or even shun or even cause my up to be exposed or to have more responsibility than me. So I do it as unto Yah. So I don't talk much. Talk very little. I move and I sing or show or instruct. That's what a sober mind does constantly. It instructs. It's not full of folly. It's not laughter. It's not a jackass of a clown. It is sober. It is watching because he knows that mind knows that the end of all things is at hand. So it's a mind that constantly prays, seeking Yah for instructions. Listen. Why? He says, and knowing all of that, understanding that, he says, and above all things, above everything, above every action, not this damnable, twisted, superficial thing we call affection. It's false. It's polluted. And I will open the door and show you what pollutes it in every last one of you. All of us. And the enemy has his hooks in your jaws. I don't care who you are. He says that above all things, not above some things, and above all things, not above 10 or 15 things. He said, but above all things, quote, everything, and above all things, have, possess, he said, above all things. We know that the end of all things at hand, he says, above all things. He says, and above all things, and above all things, and above all things, and above all things, and above all things. We're so damn twisted in our logic, we don't hear y'all. Because it's a story to us. It's just reading a book. I was talking to one the other day and they kept emphasizing a word. I'm telling them it's not so. He says, the person says to me, no, you are injecting something into the conversation. I say, it's not so. You constantly use this expression. I said, okay, let's define this word by Webster. And so when I define the word, well, it doesn't mean that. I said, no, sir, it means that. It means that, friend. You're trying to define it for your occasion. No, it means that. And he means what he says. You cannot lie. He says above all things, above everything, above every affliction, above every agonizing, complex battle, above all encroachments of hell, above all things. Above everything, above all things is what Yah says, above all things, he says, have fervent, above everything, above your laughter, your clouding, he said, have fervent, Above all things, have fervent love for who? For you among yourselves. Above everything. I don't give a damn about your prayer life. He said, above all things, fervent love. I don't give a damn about your self-righteousness. He said, above all things, have fervent love. Above all things. This is the Torah. Above all things, above all your battles, have fervent love toward among yourselves. Above all things, above all your battles, you must have that. We can try to extrapolate this any way we want to. It is simple. He said above all things, as he said in verse 7, but the end of all things. He says in verse 8, and above all things, he says, I want you to have this great haba, this great burning love that is cherished. That is what habab is. It is something that one cherishes. When someone cherishes something, do they not put it in a place that is special? Do they not protect it? Do not they watch over that and make sure it's protected? A mother cherishing her daughter does not, she protect her daughter. A father cherishing his son, is there not protection? A man cherishing his wife, does he not protect her? A wife cherishing her husband, does she not protect him? We got this damn superficial commodity in our hearts, and it's wrong. It's not the genuine deal. Above all things, above all things. Above all things. I'm going to bring it home. Don't worry. Let there be fervent love among yourselves, for love shall cover a multitude of sin. Yeah, it's love, isn't he? He covers our sin, doesn't he? When a man has that kind of fervency, you know that there's the witness of his truth in that man. When a woman has that, you know that. And so the Torah applies or obedience even to a husband and also with a man to his wife. It is beautiful because they have the fervency of Yah's great love. They have the haba. It is what you cherish. And what you cherish, you do not expose to anything. You do not trust that to anything, anyone, or under any circumstances. When you cherish your child, you don't let them out of your sight. You don't go to Walmart and let your babies just roam and say, I'll get them when I leave. You don't do that. The fervency of Yah's love doesn't just roam and speculate and question. It doesn't do that. Because Yah said, I put them under your feet, Moshe. I love them so great, I would trust them with no one but you. And he has trusted us with no one but Yahshua HaMashiach. And Yahshua said, because you trusted with me before a sin, he descended and he gave gifts unto men to bring us into the perfect Torah, wisdom and understanding, that we may sit at the feet of the messengers of Yah and hear. This damn twisted generation. You got faggots trying to counsel folks and they're faggots. You got stupid women that have no knowledge of truth trying to counsel children and overseeing and teaching them. That's what you have in these dirty whorehouses. It's one thing that your life will emanate the strength of your testimony. Your look will do that. The way you carry yourself. I don't care if you're dirty. Or you've taken a bath like I have this evening. It makes no difference. It is a pronouncing of the profoundness of that man. Look at him. Even that woman. They said of Yahshua, we haven't seen a man like him. You think they didn't say that of the prophets? Who is this man? You've never been in a place where someone walks in, everyone turns? I've seen that. You think if Michael Jordan walked in the mall in Charlotte, everyone would not turn their head? This is a silly generation. Hear this, Yisrael. And then he tells us in verse 9, he says, use hospitality one to another. He says, without loon, without grudging. Now, this is the catalyst here. I know what I said on the Shabbat. One of the most diabolical spirits of hell, it is expressed in this thing that Yah calls Lun. Lun. I want to define that according to its Hebraic definitive. Lun is a murmurer. One that loves murmuring. I want to show you the deviousness of this. We think we're going to get by. We don't realize what it does to us. He said, let everything be done without grudging. Lun. It is murmuring, and it is the spirit of muttering. It's an enchantment. I say things because I know what I'm saying. We will question things because your ears are not ready for that. It is a spirit of muttering, and this is the catalyst of it. It is when one holds something secret or a secret displeasure and not openly avowing to it, to say to my hope, my Aka, I don't like what you're doing. I don't like you. They hold it in their shot. It is called Lun. It is called Lun. It is a spirit of muttering and murmuring, and they secretly hold that displeasure, I don't like him, in their hearts, and they will not openly avow to it. Even when one questions them, they will say, well, that's not me. It is the spirit of hell. And we don't realize, Yisrael, when we allow that emotion to begin to operate. I will show us, don't worry. We don't realize what we're doing. That's why every word that Yah speaks is important to understand. That's why we need to labor, we need to research, we need to dig deep into the Torah. You understand? It doesn't take much to buy a Hebrew dictionary. It is loon, to murmur, murmuring, to mutter. It is a secret displeasure, not openly avowed. It is when one always complains. They complain about every damn thing. You're quiet, huh? It is when one complains. And not only do they complain, but they abide in that. And they remain in that kind of a mindset. That's the devious damnation of it when we remain there. We cause ourselves to be brought under the loon, that we murmur and we disavow it. Oh, I don't have anything against you, Ak. You're a liar. Your heart is not right. It's not pure toward Yisrael. It's not right toward the Yisrael like Kiroshim. And then you will not openly avow to that. There is something that is secretive, that is called Lutz. It is of the demonic construct. And if you remain in that, woe unto you, Yisrael. You're going to wake up in the derision of darkness, whereby your mind cannot become cognate or responsive unto the Torah. That's why we don't respond. That's why there's no Amen. That's why they will rejoice. That's why we're not happy when we hear. We don't want y'all to correct us. We don't want y'all to reprove us. We don't want y'all show me my wicked ways. Yeah, we don't want that. We don't want that today. We don't want y'all to try us. Search us and see if there be any wicked thing. We don't want that. You want some kind of twisted, effeminate man to appease us in all of our wickedness. You won't find that with me. You will go to hell. Not me. I don't give a damn about you. You don't give a damn about my Abba. Damn you. And that's a fact. I said to one of my natural kinsmen, my natural sister, she says to me, you ought to call your older brother. Said, I'm not going to call him. I'm not. I know the mindset of the fool, and I will not call him. Now, if he wants to talk to me, that's a different ball game. Let him call me. I will not do it. I'll call you, though. I'll call you. I want to show us something here. The word loom, he says, do all things, use kindness or hospitality. It's amazing that, the word hospitality, as I say to people, I want to show you one of the hotz. She gave the hotz here an offering because of the great splendor. It's not that many of you all of the work. She was simply appreciative of how we prepared for those that came, just a few, but still, what a great blessing. And I said to my Ishel, then let us be kind toward her. Let that reciprocate. And hospitality is having this open heart to all. I hate what I see among Yah's people. We disavow my brother. No, I would tell you, brother, get your damn wicked heart right. I would say to my little sister, you're stubborn, you're hard-headed. You got mess in you. I see it in your forehead. Get your little damn wicked heart right. That's love. And the world will stomp your ass into hell. That we should show hospitality, Yisrael. And we don't do it grudgingly. Oh, I don't want to. No, you don't do it that way. You don't do it murmuring. You don't do something for one and then murmur about it. You don't be kind to one and then speak about that. It's wrong, Yisrael. We're teaching our children that. You're teaching yourself that. You're teaching those that are in your social or social grouping or clique. It's wrong. I'm a man that all I do is talk Yah. I talk Yah. And that should be our conversation. We don't have time for foolishness. We can't murmur. We can't have this grudging or begrudge one another. And then the saddest part, we'll abide there and then we remain there. Hallelujah. I want to show you the spirit that hinders you from doing everything. There's only one. One of the most powerful that we accuse everyone. And we never accuse ourselves. Yahshua, as he speaks, and this word is for us today here in Yahkahan. Yahkahan chapter 6. The question asks, what do we do that we may work the works of Yah? John chapter 6, verse 43. The question was asked, what shall it take? What shall we do that we may work the righteousness or the tzedek of Yah? And Yahshua says in Yahkahan 6:43, Yahshua therefore answered and said to them, he says, I don't want you to hari. He said, murmur not among yourself. Can I read some of that? Hallelujah. Yahkahan 6. Let me find this quickly. Hallelujah. It says in verse 41, then the Yahudim then, hallelujah, they began to murmur at him because he said, I am the bread of life which came down from Hashemam. And they said, is this not Yahshua HaMashiach or Yahshua, the son of Yosef, who's a Vatanima, we Yada, we know? How's it then that he shall say, I come down from heaven? Yahshua answered and said unto them, he said, do not murmur among yourself. No man can come to me except the Abba which has sent me draws him, and I will raise him up in the last days. It is written in the prophets, and they shall be taught by Yah. So why is it that we can't do no works or the mighty works of Yah? Why we cannot operate? Is Yah Ahab? Is he love? Then why can we not operate in that great power of Yah? Because there is much hagi. There's much witchcraft among the people of Yah. We are
Hagi, we are whispering.
That's what Yisrael does. It loves to whisper.
It loves to plot. That is what Hagi is. It whispers and it plots. We don't realize the damnation that we are storing in our bosom. It is the whispering people. Oh, he comes. No, I don't ever talk like that. Because what I says that concern my ark here, if I said to him, I said it before him. You understand? I don't have to whisper. So when you come around me, I'm not whispering anything. I will talk loud. No, it is Hagi. It is to say, and when he comes, you get quiet. You don't want to incorporate or bring them in into this seance of darkness that has corrupt your damn heart and every kind of evil thing proceeds out of that. I will show us, and you have constructed something so damnable, so twisted in your mind, it's going to bring you down to the gates and the walls of hell, and that's a fact. You love to whisper and complain. You love to talk. You lie on your bed. We're wicked. We loud our bed. And our demise is against Israel. What a damn wicked Jezebel. And what a fool I am. Not going to be with me because I know Torah. It is something that we literally meditate on. We think about it. We think about being aggressive and to regress from others. It's wrong. It's evil. It's not of Yah. Hagi. Hagi. Almost, that doesn't, it sounds that way. H-A-W hyphen. G-H-E-E-G. Hagi. It sounds kind of spooky, doesn't it? You might as well say, oh man. You sit here like, you get excited over a damn piece of flannel at Walmart. Get excited over Yah. Listen to this. We cannot do any mighty works because we murmur, we hagi, we love to whisper. And that's what they did with Yahshua. They were whispering. He can't be him. He's not all what she says she is. And there's this always a plotting. Plotting. We say things and it creates a plot in the minds of those that hear it. And that's the truth, Yisrael. It's always plotting. It's wrong. And don't tell me it's not among his nation, because that's who they're speaking to. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the reason we're doing that, because we have such idolatry in us. And if we don't think that murmuring is the very root of idolatry, you're fool. Let me show you. Hallelujah. Go to Bimidbar here. Numbers chapter 14, verse 27. Do we know what has transpired here with Yisrael? Haran has built them a golden demonic power and said, this is what delivers us. So it says in the book of Bimidbar, Numbers 14, 27, Yosef says to Moshe, how long shall I bear this evil, this ra, this malignant, Numbers 14, 27. He says, an evil congregation. While the evil which murmur, they loon. They have this grudge against Yah. They have this begrudging against Yah, which loon, which murmur against me. I've heard their murmuring. I've heard the murmuring of the children of Yisrael, which they murmur against me. Are we the body of Yisrael? Yeah, we're the body of Yahshua. So if I murmur against my Ak or my Chota, am I murmuring against Yah? If I'm speaking and Hagi in whisper or meditation, they're on my mind not to entreat them with kindness in this great Habab, but with this vile spirit of corruption, I greet them and I know my heart is not right. Greet each other. Embrace each other. I can't stand a cowardly hug. I don't like that. Don't even hug me. Hug me like a man. You're not dealing with a boy. Put that heart here. Let me feel it. Let me feel your heartbeat. That's what I like. He said, this is an evil congregation. They murmur. They loon. They remain. They will not progress. And when you find a nation of people that murmur, they never progress. You find one that loon, they never progress. They never move beyond the captivity of that idolatrous thing in them. They never progress. They will never, never. And that's why Yisrael, we have digressed. We have not progressed. Yah says they murmured against me. I ask us the question, did not Yahshua give gifts unto men before he ascended into Hashemayim? Yeah. He gave the gifts. Has nothing to do with you. It is the spirit of the most ultimate idolatrous practice. Because it is hagi, it is murmuring, it is calling when one mutters. My grandmother would say, what do you say, boy? You mutter something under your breath, boy. That's what they would say. Because you're drawn on your own resolve, your own strength. When one is muttering, that's what they're doing. They're calling upon the God of their belly. And we think we're getting by. Are you trying to frighten us? We don't fear Yah. Hell frighten us. We do some of the most wickedest things. And try to frighten us. Hell doesn't make anyone afraid. Hell, we're wicked. And we do wickedly. Were those his people? And he said, this evil congregation, that's all they do is loon. When you loon, you know you're evil. That's all they do is murder and complaint. They do it secretive. They do it in this hagi. They do it in the secret corners, and they find their conclaves to talk. When they are come, they get quiet. Hey, brother. And they greet him falsely. That's wrong. Yeah. It's wicked. Yeah. That's not even duplicity. That's not even harakola. That's not even lukewarm. It's wrong, Yisrael. And I see the dearth of that among the nation. I don't care where you go. I see it. We are a small microcosm of the whole. So if it's among us, you know it's true. This damn polluted thing they call love. How can you even love? Herein is love. That you keep the mitzvah of Yah. If you can't love your neighbor like yourself, how can you love your brother? We're born from the same mama. It doesn't mean a damn thing. My natural cousin shot his brother in the back. His oldest brother killed him dead in his mother's front yard. Well, I will never do that. You kill your sister and your brother dead by coveting their wickedness and their sin, for the end of sin is death. When sin is finished, it brings forth a separation from Yah. And so in the conclaves of gathering, in this muttering, people don't pray. They don't cry out unto Yah. They don't say, search me, Yah, as Dawid said, and see if there be any wicked thing. And we don't do that. That's why we have to watch and pray always. We allow things to remain in us. Something is wrong. If I allow something to remain in me, and I bring it up what she did 10 years ago, 5 years ago, or you bring something up what I did 10 years ago, or 10 days ago. You haven't forgiven me 7 times 7, yeah? Something is wrong in our minds. Something is twisted with us. You're sick. That's why we draw on those things, because it is the demonic power. Did not Yisrael draw on the strength of Mizraim? We ate plenty flesh. We sat by the flesh pot, the garlic we ate. And you brought us out here to destroy us. Yah's trying to bring you out of you, because he's going to destroy you. Yeah. Hallelujah. Quickly in 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians. Hallelujah. When one began to practice any form of idolatry, it is associated with this spirit here. 1 Corinthians 10:10. Shaul says, and we know what he speaks to the Corinthians about concerning, he speaks to them to warn them to Naha against their idolatrous practices and their ways that are not conducive unto spiritual growth. And this is one of the nuggets of wisdom he speaks to them. He says, neither, look what he used here. He used the word nigga, almost like nigga. He used the word nigga, nigga. The Torah is a lamp, it's a near. He used the word near. See, listen, now the Torah is a lamp. Now those that murmur, their murmuring is their lamp. He used nigga. Can I tell you what the word nigga is? It is a tail barrier. It is one that backbite. It is a slanderous liar. It is one that murmur and whisper. You understand? I'm glad, preacher, you take time. You sit there for hours. You go through concordance and you look and you dig till you find it. Hallelujah. I'm glad you do that, preacher man. For me. He says, neither nigger, neither be a backbiter or a liar. A one that lie against your heart, and you have no evidence of proof, but the word of one that is a witness, and their witness is not strong. They're not examples of the epitome of true love or the activities of the Ruach operating in them. And then you take that advice, he says, not a slanderous, don't whisper with them against him, against her, against those, against them. I'm blatantly up front. And that's the way it should be. How can a silly man stand up here and instruct us? How can a silly woman instruct you that's full of this nigger? They cannot. He says, neither murmur you as some of them also. Listen now. He uses the word rohin here. How do you know this? Because I search and I dig. I search and I dig. I search and I dig. I search. He says, as some of you also, Rogain, you were backbiters. You grumble. And above all, you rebel against Yah. That's what Rogain, you rebel against his command. He said, and you rebel against Yah. And he says, and you were Shohath. Yah destroyed you, other destroyer. It is going to be your own insidious cancer that's going to eat on you. We don't realize the damage. I say to my Ishaw, don't shut your mouth, woman. Don't, I don't want, I don't, she doesn't have to tell me this and that. I don't want to tell me that and this. You understand that? You do right. You do right. Regardless. You know, there are men that are so weak. And the Torah speaks of this. They allow their emotions to damn Torah. And the Torah said, I'm going to kill you, bastard. I will show us. There are those that cannot see the weakness of their wife, their children. Like my mother, she can never see the wrong I did. And my aunt. Oh, I will knock on wood. My babies, they're doing nice. That's what they would say. And so when they would hear things of this one or that one's child, it was, oh, I'm just glad my babies. They were there with them. I will mind. They were there with them. And you think that you got something that's better? We were doing the same things. We were dirty. We're filthy. We're all wicked. It is wrong. It's wrong. We defend Israel. We defend the whole house. This wicked, stubborn generation. I don't give a damn if you don't love me. And that's a fact. Hallelujah. Neither let us be murmurers or this Rohin, because did not Yah destroy those over 2,000 when they built the golden calf? And Yah says, who's on my side? And the Levites said, we're on your side. And they pull out their sword and kill them because of an idol, did he not? So it is in this hour. You don't think it's an idol because it's you, but I will show you, Israel. It's us. I'm sure it is. No doubt about it. He's speaking to me. He's speaking to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Reason there is no great perfection of his habab, his fervent love, is because we're just not clean. We're filthy. Our minds are filthy. Our hearts are filthy. It is right, man, because we have not gone through the purifying process. Can I ask you a question? How in hell can someone indulge in every kind of wicked activity? They set the evil things before their eyes. That we said, I set no evil thing before my eyes. I hate all them that despise you, Yah. He said, I hate them with a perfect hatred. So how can I be a man, sit there all day, with my eyes in tune with all kind of evilness, all night long, eating hamburgers and hot dogs and cookies and damn potato chips and watching every kind of stupid, silly movie there is, and think I have the ability to teach, to instruct, or you have the ability to counsel, or someone give you wisdom, or you're going to give someone wisdom of a matter? You don't have a damn thing. There's one thing about the powerful pulsating Mara, or the Ma'or of Yah, the Ma'or. It is a light that burns fervently with great excitement. And I don't care where I go. I don't sit boastfully. I just see it all the time. It excites me. I don't care if my jeans are dirty or what. It excites me. I see what Yah does. I'm not the butthole. I'm the head. And I carry myself that way. You better know that. And you're going to realize it too. You're going to know he's the head, not the butthole. Why is it that we are so filthy with these things? Kefa, give us a reason why. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. 1 Peter 1, 22. He says this. Seeing you have purified your nephesh by obeying the Torah through the Ruach in the unfeigned. It is sincere Israelite brotherly kindness. You see how we purify ourselves? We cleanse ourselves by obeying the truth. That's how we do it. Have you ever found yourself stubborn that you know it's right to do and you just don't do it? You ever been in that predicament? You all been in that. You know it's right to do. He that knoweth it is right or tough to do and do it not, it is sin. You know it's right to do and you don't do it. It's wrong. It's right, wife, to obey your husband in all things. It's right, man, for you to love your wife. And you don't obey him? You don't love your wife? Those that will say, I've watched that with those that have come, lived here. Well, what are the other sisters doing? Or what are the brothers doing? Makes no damn difference what they're doing. If you work as unto Yah, makes no difference if they're not doing anything. You still do it. I don't say that to my issue at work. She gets up. I massage her hand for 15 minutes. She didn't want me to stop. I said, I got to get up now, 6 o'clock. But that's how we are. Do I love her like I love her? Sure. It is the same. I'm concerned about her. I'll talk to her husband and say, do this, this, and that. What? Don't worry about what. That's your problem. Your busybodies. Sure I do. He talks to her. But it's wrong. Love doesn't do that. He says we purify ourselves by obeying the truth. And we do it through the Ruach. Yah is Ruach. But it must be a love that is sincere for Yisrael. And that love is kindness. That love is kindness. Did not this Ema express that to you, Hope, when she gave you all a card? Well, then it reciprocates kindness. You give it to me, I give it all back. Because your kindness means more to me than this. I wouldn't sell your kindness out for nothing. Here, I give it all back to you. It may not be in that form, but I give it back. That's the way I am. I remember this preacher said to me 25 years ago, my Ya'ak. He said, I want to be kinder to you than you are to me. And I've never lost perspective on that. It must be sincere kindness. It has to be kindness. A man can look at a woman and see that there's no kindness there. A woman can say, he ain't no kind man. He's a mean old man. It must be kindness. Hallelujah. And the only way kindness comes is through sincere love for Yah. You love Yah by obeying his commandments. To love Yah with all your heart, soul, mind, all your strength. To love your neighbor as yourself. Upon these hinge the whole 613 laws of Yah. If you obey that, then you will operate in the Ruach of Yah. You obey all that he commands you to do. We don't have no kindness. We have learned this damn thing that mama taught us and daddy, which were in their Baptist whole houses, their Methodists, their Pentecostal dog houses. And it was a damn superficial lie. They didn't give a damn about nobody but theirs and their own. And we don't give a damn about nobody but those that we perceive are our own. And that's just the truth. It's the truth. We protect our own. We don't protect Yah. I protect Yisrael. There was a man called, he was a boy. He said what he was going to do to Akshim. I said, you're not going to do a thing. He said, come through me. Oh, I'm going to do this. I said, boy, hold up. You got to come through me first. You don't want to do that. I said, you're not going to do anything to no one. Nobody. How about that? When I broke him down, my Amy began to apologize. I said, you don't even have the wherewithal, boy. You get through me, you don't want to get to him. This wicked generation. That's how we should defend each other. I do offend you. Same thing for you. And that's the way it should be. You need hope we defend them. Come on. They're wrong. You tell them they're wrong. You're a damn child of hell when you can't tell someone when they're wrong. If you're wise, anyone wise receive any kind of musar. They love instruction. Wise man, he loves instructions. It's a blessing to him. A damn fool despises it. About the design, you all don't. You do things that are serious. You don't have time to play and laugh and foolishness. You don't even see the children doing that all the time. They play. But even in them, you see a soundness there. It is the truth, man. You see them playing the youth. I watch them all the time. His daughters come. Rafael have them, watching them. They're playing. They're doing this. They're cooking. They're doing that. But it's a soberness to their cooking. You give them some mud cakes. They get out there in the yard and I watch them play mud. I perceive. I watch things. I don't know about you, but I watch stuff like that. You don't hear the frivolity among children. And they share with each other. I like that. I promised them I would get when I go out. I haven't been out really. I had to do some things today, but I had to pick up some things for the cows. I will get them some, as Marillo says, some wholesome candy. Maybe from the natural food store somewhere. And so I only had 3 pieces the day of the peppermint. And Rafael always gets to me, they don't need that. Oh, give them, I buy it for them. Give them a piece. And so I said to Abner, I said, it's no piece for you. And so Hava says, I don't want that kind. I don't want it. So Saria says, can I have it? She said, okay. Just that kindness. Just even a kind word. We are so crazy, we don't even like to speak to each other. I don't like talking to an Akh before I say shalom. In the morning, shalom, Akh. Hold up, shalom, shalom. I don't care what my emotions are, how I'm feeling. I want to speak to my Akh, to greet him. Yah greets us every morning. Get up. He greeted me this morning. Get up out of the bed, boy. And I got up with breath in my loins. And I'm glad. Something is wrong when it's difficult for us to speak to each other. When Yisraya, they find, but they go to the word, hi. Not me. Can I proceed a little farther? Hallelujah. This is coming at the renewed covenant, isn't it? I like this. He says in 1 Peter 1:22, seeing that you have purified your nephesh in obeying the Torah through the Ruach, in unfeigned, sincere, Yisraelite brotherly kindness, see that you love one another with a pure heart. Then he uses the word fervently again, tomid, that is perpetual and continuously, that you love each other fervently. Did I not read that in Devarim as I started this teaching? Yeah. To understand the capacity of the Habab of Yah, this great fervent love that continues, this kindness, this great strength of beauty that is expressed from our countenance, our fellowship, our embracing each other. I want to embrace them just like I do my wife. With that same love. I want to embrace my Akh with the same kind of love I embrace my Akh. Most men don't have that. They don't like to embrace. They don't like to show any kind of love. Because their lives have been shattered by mama and daddy. They have not nurtured them in the proper understanding of that. And they don't know how to do it. It's almost a withdrawal. They don't have that ability. Same thing with the bath. It is sad. So we must be retaught. We have to be retaught. Hallelujah. Shaul expressed his great affection to those in Phalicia, Philippians chapter 1. This is what he says in verse 8. Listen to this. Hear this. I don't know if I want Yah to record this, all right? As he expresses great affection for the house and how his prayers are constantly before unto Yah for them, he says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 8, for Yah is my record. Oh, don't you know he records everything? For Yah is your record. You can say all you want to. He said, for Yah is my record, how greatly I long after you in the Habab. See, I know it says bows, but that is it. In the fervent love, he says, of Yeshua HaMashiach, to cherish you, to love you. He said, how? Yah is my record. I love not to you. Yah stands before me. I stand in the presence of Yah. If I'm phony, I'm a liar. He said, let it be recorded today what great, fervent my Habab, how I cherish you, how I love you, how I long for you. This damn mess we call love is not worth a damn thing. Don't tell me you love me. It's not worth a damn. It's phony. You don't love daddy, mama, sister, brother, more than you love anyone. He commands us to love your neighbor as you love you. He commands you to honor your avat and your ima. Nowhere in Torah he commands that. For love is love, man. It is not segregated. It is not. It doesn't foster an emotion from my mama, who is my mother. I will, man. Don't try to stop me. Joshua said, who is my mother? Who are those of the house of Israel? Those that hear the Torah and do the will of my Abba. The same is the house of Israel. You to have an emotion that is segregated or respect, you are going to hell. I don't give a damn who you are. Those that have no husband, you teach them the beauty of a wife. You teach them the beauty of a wife and how to be clothed as a wife. You teach them. You got time for murmuring, raising him, and we feel our guts, don't we? Don't even mention that. I know I feel mine. Hallelujah. Greedy. I'm greedy as a hog. We don't have time to teach and to instruct. That the beauty of Yisrael, it is expressed in the bath to Zion. That's where his beauty is expressed in the woman. That's why he calls her bath. You take showers, but there's nothing like a bath, is it? And our baths look grotesque. They look dirty. And it's wrong. You teach them the beauty, the quality of a woman. And man, you must teach the young man the strength of a man by your example, your labor, your work. I said to Simeon, I said, all these trees, Shem, we'll get over here and cut them. He's going to need that. Well, I know I didn't send you squares of the day, but I sent you a lot of wood. I say his stoves eats it up. Yo, Nahwe, you all get this. I piled it up. And say, come back and make sure you take your hammer. Make sure he got wood. That's how we should look after each other. You don't have to tell me to do that. It should be just a passion. I see him working. You think I, come on. This wicked house. Listen to what Yah says. Hallelujah. For Yah is my record, how greatly I long after you in my chabab, and my bowels of Yeshua HaMashiach. He said, and this I pray, that your love may abound yet. Look how love abounds to grow more and more. When you began to understand the knowledge of Yah, and then when you began to understand all judgment, we're going to be judged, Yisrael. See, and that's how love grows. When we understand, we're going to be judged. We don't believe that we're going to be judged. That's why we can have this type of corruption in us. And it comes by the secretive practice of the underworld, of the gods that you have created in your mind. They are idolatrous images. That my Ishaw is more valuable than her or him or him or you or you. That's not true. Yeah. Or your wife is not true. Yeah. Or she adds more. Not true. Yeah. Or my husband. Not so. It's not so. You're against you because you're against Yah. That's almost like little children when they start playing, they get upset. Everybody's mad at me. They all mad at me. Yeah, they're being mean to me. And Ahava's mad at me. And Hadassah. Papi Sari and Abner, they're being mean to me. All right, you're coming, hugger. It's the reality. We can see. Come on, Yisrael. Children do that. I'm a man. Hallelujah. The book of Wisdom expressed something that is just so profound. Wisdom 6 and 11. And I want to deal with that in the book of Maccabees. I want to show you something here. It says here in the book of Wisdom, chapter 6, verse 11. Wisdom says this, wherefore, he says, set your affection or your emuna. I know we use the word, but emuna is our fidelity, our faithfulness. He says, set your affection, that which you are devoted to, you're zealous behind, set your affections, Yah says, upon my word. That's why Yahshua said, set your affection on things that are above, because his word is from above. Wisdom chapter 6, verse 11. Shaul spoke the same thing. He wrote the same thing that Yahshua said. So we should set our emuna, our fidelity, our zealousness upon the word of Yah. Why? Long for them. Why? For you shall be instructed. We set our affection upon the word of Yah. We need to be instructed. I read that before I move into this. It's important. The book of Maccabees, 4th Maccabees. I found this because I found it. You have to understand the very ferociousness of the nature of those warriors of Yah. They defended one thing, and that was truth. And they fought for the kingdom of Yisra'iyah. They fought for truth, and they were warriors. They were mighty, powerful men. And so the wisdom speaks here in the book of Maccabees. For Maccabees chapter 2, verse 7, as this speaks on what caused us to have this controversy with the Torah, and the word Maccabee means hammer. That's what it means, hammer. It says this in Maccabees chapter 2, verse 7. It speaks of the wisdom of the Torah. It says, otherwise, how could it be that someone who is a habitual, this is what it says, someone that is a habitual, solitary, gromanizer, those that are just greedy and love to eat, foolishness, folly, food, lust, whatever. How is it that one can be a solitary gromanizer, a glutton, even a drunkard can learn a better way? How is it? Can they learn the truth? How's it when we're so consumed with our flesh and our emotions, how can we learn the truth of Yah? If we're so absorbed in us and we're eating our flesh, how can we learn the truth? So he uses the examples of one that is a habitual gromadizer. Can't stop eating. Can't stop eating your folly, your muttering, your whispering. How can one be drunk? How do they even learn Haderach? They can't learn it. Unless reason is clearly mastered over emotions. You got to get emotions out of it. Yah says to Yisra'iyah, come let us reason where? Out of the Torah. Unless reason, the reasoning of Torah, supersede your trash emotions over emotions. It says, master rules according to the knowledge, and a lord rules with emotions. We have lorded over the heritage of Yah. We have become lords unto ourselves, and your Lord rules over your emotions. The Torah commands us to have fervent love. It instructs us to be kindly affectionate. It instructs us to show hospitality one unto another. It commands us to do that. But because of our emotions, we don't allow our emotions to reason as to what the Torah says. Hear this, Yisra'iyah. It says this, as soon as a man adopts a way of life in accordance with Torah, if your lives are constrict according to Torah, even though he is a lover of money, he is forced to act keri, contrary. He is forced. When you become a lover of Torah, you are forced to do things that are contrary to your flesh. You're forced to do things that are contrary to your actions, your deeds, and your attitude. When you become a lover of Torah, if you're not a lover of Torah, you will not do things that are keri. When a man becomes a lover of Torah, he is forced. He adopts a way of life according to the Torah. Even though he's a lover of money, he is forced to act contrary to his natural ways. See, our natural way says, I love my daddy more than I love your daddy. It's wrong. You love Yisrael. He's forced to do that. And so we do things according to what we believe is natural ways. And leads without interest to the needy. And he lends to the interest without needy, and he canceled the debts of those after 7 years. What is he saying? When we began to walk according to Torah, we give unto those that need help. We give unto those that need love. We give unto those that need compassion. We give unto those that need a word of strength. And we don't do things to be seen. We give to the needy. And those that have sinned against us, 7 days, we forgive them. It's over. We're never reminded of it. That's what he's saying. He's saying that without the 7 days, 7 years, it says you don't owe me anything. Go. No. Don't worry about it. Well, we do things according to Torah. We have this convoluted spirit among Yisrael, and these Maccabees, the hammer said, no, you're not going to do this. Under Ptolemy, under the governments of that time. And so when one does things according to the Torah, one says, I forgive you. It's been 7 days I've had this in my bosom. It's been 7 weeks I had it. It's been 7 years. You're a wicked beast if you don't. Give a damn who you are. And you don't bring it up to no man, to no woman. You don't do it. Okay, what she has done against me, even if she's committed adultery against me, if it's pleasing to live with her, I don't ever bring that up. Never. I don't even want to remember that. I want our times of beauty to be expressed in a way that that's not even an issue, a blimp. You're good choir, but that's all right. There are choir out there too. Hallelujah. Listen to this. Hear me. Verse 9. If one is bosak, if one is greedy, just covetous, they have this unrighteous violence about them. That is what Bosak is. They're just greedy. He is ruled by the Torah. If one is greedy, he is ruled by the Torah through his reasons, so that he neither glean his harvest or gather the last grapes from the vineyard. In other matters, we can recognize that reason, and that is ovin, that is one's own iniquity. When you reason in your mind, it is an iniquity spirit. That ones that recognize that reason rules over the emotion. And then he says this, for the Torah prevails against and over affection. I don't give a damn who it is, my wife, my children. The Torah prevails. You're wrong and wicked. And so you makes no damn difference. Torah prevails over emotion. Well, that's my brother. Damn him, he's a pig. That's my sister. She's a wicked liar. She's greedy. She's unstable emotionally. And tell her. You don't sit around. Torah prevails over emotions. Yeah. Torah prevails. I don't give a damn if you get mad at me. Yeah. You see that we are so foolish that when Yah speaks to us, and we don't see him trying to reason in our bosom to show us we're damn fools. And you're going to die that way. Yeah. Keep on living that way. That's all right. When we hear the Torah of Yah, we don't harden our hearts. We look at me. I said to the old man, tonight we're going to need what I'm going to preach. He said, yeah, we need it. I said, no, you need it. And I need it. This damn foolish generation, I despise it. That's why I don't like to congregate with too many people. I love the ark. I really do. But I like to leave men
to talk because it's just a foolish generation. And sometimes I like the solitary of just studying and seeking Yah. And that's just the truth. Listen to this. Listen to what he says in verse 10. For the Torah prevails even over affections for parents. Anyone has Maccabees? Who got Maccabees 4? Who got that? You got that in your writing? You need to read this. You got that on the system back, Doc Simeon? Does it say that? It says, for the Torah prevails. Does it say that? Let me hear amen or something. Does it say that? It said the Torah prevails even over affection for, does it say parents? Does it say parents? You don't shun the Torah for parents. Over parents, so that virtue, or higher, the wealth and the strength of Yah's wealth, so higher, or his virtue, is not abandoned for their sake. You abandon the Torah for your daughter's sake? For your son, your wife, your children, your mama? I will, told that my friend. At least we got one alive in here. Hallelujah. One. We got one. The Torah prevails against parents. The virtue of the Torah prevails. And then if we reduce it, woe unto us, it is an idolatrous spirit. And we began to murmur at Yah. This my mama, this my sister, this my brother. No, you're my brother. You that are listening and love Yah, you're my sister. You are. I have one natural biological sister, but she's not my sister. We have no fellowship. It tells us the attributes of Torah. It is superior to the love for one's wife. That's Torah. It's superior for my love for her. It is superior. It is superior for man's love for his wife, so that one rebukes her when she breaks the Torah. Shut your damn mouth, woman. Hold on. No, just be quiet. And if the Torah prevails in her, yes, sir. Thank you, husband. Don't try to straighten me out. Don't even try it. Don't do that. Don't ever. Don't do that. You do anything but try to straighten me out and show me where I'm wrong, you're in trouble. You. All right. Don't show me my wrong. I don't need you to do that. Your beauty shows me my wrong. Your beauty, your submissiveness unto Torah shows me my wrong. You don't have to speak to me. So that, my friend, he will rebuke his wife when she's wrong. Verse 12, it takes precedence over love for children so that one punish them for their misdeeds. It takes precedence. Are we the children of Yah? Is Yahshua the living Torah? He's going to punish us for our misdeed. Keep walking in your wicked ways. It is sovereign. Listen. It makes no damn difference. It is sovereign over relationship of friends. Torah supersedes friendship. Torah supersedes sisters and brothers. Truth does. It is sovereign. It is sovereign. Even over relationship. So that one rebukes his friend when they act wickedly. You ever rebuke your brother, your sister when they act wickedly? You watch them act wickedly and you don't say a thing? So that one rebukes, it's in the book. It is the truth. So that when one acts wickedly, that's you're wicked, sister. Brother, you're wicked. You all don't want to be, you don't want to work around me because when I work and get to sweating and I'm hot, I like the role. Now, don't. Just give me what I'm giving you now. You don't have to do it the way I do. But you give me that, we're all right. You're all right. Just give me what I give you. You give me that, that's all right. That's all right. That's all I ask for. But you give me what I give you. Just give me what I give you. And yet the Torah is sovereign over relationship and friend, so that even a friend, when a friend does wrong, you say, that's wrong, friend. That's wrong for you to do that. Even the world does that. They say, you're wrong. That's wrong for you to say that. It'd be wrong for me to allow my Israel to come and then say things that, what is it based upon? Against this, for what? We can't do that. Matter of fact, she keeps a lot of things in her. She doesn't talk to me when it comes to that. Do not consider a paradoxia or a statement or something, something that is a paradox. It is something, a statement that has truth, and yet it's a lie. So it's just something, well, you know what I meant. No, don't even consider that. When reason through the Torah can prevail, the Torah can prevail even over enmity, even over your hatred, your abba, even over your hostility. When you began to look into the depths of the Torah and you let that supersede in everything, even over your abba, even when there's hatred and animosity, Torah will prevail over that. Even when you're murmuring and muttering, Torah will prevail over that. It will deliver you even from that. It says the fruit tree of the enemy, they are not cut down. But one preserve the property of enemy from the destroyer and help raise up what is fallen. In essence, even your enemies. It is evident that reason rules even the more violent emotions. When we get violent in our emotions, we get crazy. It's because you're trying to reason in your own corrupt mind and you get violent. You get to talking loud and fast and you have no concept. Lust for power, vain honor, boasting, you become arrogant and malice. For the temperate mind, see, when a mind is temperate by the Torah, it repels all these malicious emotions. When our minds are temperate by Torah, all these emotions that are full of maliciousness, it repels that. Why? Just as it repels anger. Because anger rests in the bosom of a fool. When one has the temperament of Torah, it repels anger and their wickedness and their falsehood. They're sincere. It's nothing like a sincere brother. I would never harm an ox. I've never harmed no man. Just don't try to harm me. You don't have to worry about me harming you. Just don't bother me, man. Please don't do that. Don't bother me. I will harm no man, but don't try to harm me. I will harm no hosts, but you will not, and I will not allow your flusinizing Jezebel spirit to erupt or corrupt anything here. I don't give a damn if you've given $1 million. It said, just as it repels anger, for it is sovereign over even this. The Torah has great power over all of our emotions, all of our anger, everything. It has it over that. And we allow the Torah of Yah to operate in our bosom. I want to close on here. There's more to this, but I want to close with this last bit from Galatia. Galatians chapter 6, verse 8. I want to show you why our conditions are the way they are. Galatia chapter 6, verse 8. For if you sold to the bazaar your flesh, shall of the flesh reap corruption, mishach. When I began to try to understand that mishach, it is a disfigurement of one's face. That's what it means when their face is disfigured. You know they're corrupt. These are not my definitives. It's what's in the book. It says, but he that sows to the ruach shall of the ruach reach life everlasting. And let us not be kutz. Let us not be weary. Or kutz is to sever the ties of the relationship with each other. Let us not be coots and well-doing. For in due season you shall reap if you faint not, if you don't get too soft. It says, for as we have time, if there is occasion, if there is an experience, for as we have opportunity, let us do tough unto all men, especially them that are of the household of the believing Yisraelites. We should do special and treat each other kind. One called me today and said, I was very impressed with the community there, with the gardens and things like that. I say, wow. I said, I'm not impressed with what you said. I said, I would have hoped that you would have said, I was impressed as I could see the great affection and love. I said, because that's what Yeshua said. That, you know, this is how old men shall know you, my Talmudim, that you have loved one toward the other. I said, I appreciate you complimenting that, but it's a letdown. If you had said that then, I would have died. I don't want people to contact us because they see a greenhouse, or me in the garden, or you working. Because they sense in the face the ponim of the people. And the whole, they are 8, 9 sisters here, that's it. Something is sick in our damn minds. We don't have a burning, fervent, great care for each other and take care of each other. Something is sick in you. You understand? That's why I let nobody come here that has not lived this way and try to instruct us in a damn thing. You, in order for you to show me what you got to get in labor with me. If you can't do that, then don't try to talk that talk to me. You got to get out in the fields and hit it with me. Don't try it. You hit it with me and show you got some of that issue in you, then we can talk. You can tell me something. You can rebuke me. But don't try that until you get in the bean field with me. Until you pick some watermelons with me. Until you harvest some sweet potatoes with me. Then you can talk. Unless you haven't done that, just hold, as they would say, hold your tongue for a moment, all right? We'll talk later on. May the riches of Yah rest upon you all, Yisrael. True affection. What corrupts affection? We just don't have it. And we better get it. I mean what I say. Hallelujah. How are you going to tell a man how to run 100 yards when you've never ran 100 yards? Had a fool one day sit right there on the barbershop step and tell me, well, you need to do this and do that. I said, man, look at this crazy man. Stupid. You think I listen to you, man? Shut up. I'm going to listen to you. You come and labor with me. You don't have to walk in my shoes. Just work with me. And you won't talk too much because you're ready to go home and rest after you finish with me. Hallelujah. So we're not going to proceed any farther with the superficial thing we call affection. It is not of Yah. You know that if we murmur about one another, what we have is of idolatry. Hallelujah. It's amazing that we as a nation or people that say they love and have a great affection for each other. Yet, believe me, Yisrael, if we think that what I do against you, I will not do it against him, we're wrong. And what I do unto them, unto my least of them, I would do it unto someone else. That's why this man back here, I've always protected him. I've always protected this man back here. I've always protected that man back there with the big beard. I've always protected that man back there. I've always protected that man back there. I've always protected that man back there. I've always protected him because I'm not going to let anyone take advantage of him because of his inability that he's hampered by. So I'm not going to do that. I wouldn't even let the old man bishop do that. How about that? He said, I've always protected him. I've always protected him. Just like I protect Yisrael. Yabrak, you always Glad that you join us tonight, my Ach Davis. How are you doing, my friend? You that have joined with us on this beautiful, on this Khatve Imat. May Yah's riches rest upon you. Zachin Yarameya be here next week. He'll be teaching. Him or Zachin, but me someone. But Zachin Yarameya will be teaching. May He strengthen us all. Let us get this truth in our hearts. And let us get real. All right? And then you see that in your walk. You know the way I used to walk. I don't walk no more. There's young ladies' hands on me. Oh, I don't. The way I used to talk. I don't talk no more. There's young ladies' hands on me. That's right. Let's do it right and walk right. If you don't love me, that's all right. You don't listen. If you don't love yourself, you can't love me. Because you must love your neighbor. When you love you, you're just going to love me. I said to one today, you're going to love me. No middle grounds with me. Next thing I knew, I heard something click, click, click. Are you still there? Are you there? Hung up on me. Sure they did. Hallelujah. I see you're either going to love me or you're going to hate me. No middle grounds with me. And I'm glad. I don't want nobody to have no middle grounds with me. You like me, you love me, that's fine. If you don't, it's still fine. You have to worry about me causing you no trouble. I don't care if you don't like me. You don't love you. So if you don't love you, you can't love nobody. When people... Well, you have this sense of hatred and this coldness. They don't know how to love because they don't love them. You love you, you know how to love. And I love me a whole lot. I love me a lot. I like looking at me. I love me a whole lot. I get on me. Who are you talking to? I'm talking to me. So I love me a whole heap a lot. Shaul said, you see this large letter I've wrote unto you? So I love me. And so when you love you that much, you love Yisrael. Hallelujah. May Yah brak you all. Let us stand to our feet. Yahshua's name. Let us turn toward you, Yerushalayim. In all things, we do brak you, Araba, for all of your kindness, your mercy. Touch your people scattered abroad. Go with Ak, Arzachin Shimri, as he travels the highway and take them all home safely, but watch over him. He has such a distance. Bless him, I pray, in Yahshua's mighty name, for his faithful kindness, his labor, his great consideration of your simple messenger. Bless him, Yah. Yes, proven to be a genuine Ach. Bless him in Yahshua's name, as you do all of my friends, all of the Achot, all of the Ach. As we know that our sins are forgiven this night, for we have been washed in the dam of Yahshua, your word. This living water tonight has washed and cleansed us. We shall go from this place not the same as we came in, and we are brand new me in Yahshua. All these blessings we ask in Yahshua's name. Hallelujah. 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 Yabarak Yisrael.